All right, well, good morning again, everyone. We are going to go ahead and get started. I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Robert Pimentel, who is our Vice President of Educational Services and Institutional Effectiveness. It is a mouthful. Dr. Pimentel, thank you so much for being here with us and providing some opening remarks and the welcome, the official welcome on behalf of the college. We truly appreciate it. And with that, I'll turn it over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ramirez. Thank you, and welcome, everyone. Thank you for being here with us today. As you know, this is one of those events that we look forward to every year. This is something that our campus has been working on for a while now, and we're very interested in seeing what comes out of this event. The population that we serve is part of our equity efforts, and it's a very important population. And in fact, we've been seeking funding and trying different things to see how we could provide more services and make sure that our students are taken care of and feel welcome at the campus. So on behalf of Fresno City College, I wanna welcome you and make sure that you know that this is an important event to us. And it means a lot for us that you've taken time out of your valuable day today to be here with us. So I'll hand it over back to Dr. Ramirez and let's keep this show on the road.
Wonderful. Thank you again, Dr. Pimentel. We truly appreciate your support. And you know, one of the reasons why we have the Rising Scholars Program at Fresno City College, which is a program that is specifically designed to provide academic counseling, advising, peer mentoring, navigational services, and resources, but ultimately a holistic experience for carceral impacted or justice involved students. And the reason why we have a program like this that can provide such services is because of people like Dr. Pimentel and truly our former president, Carol Goldsmith, now our chancellor, Chancellor Goldsmith, who have remained steadfast champions of this program. So truly, if it weren't for Dr. Pimentel and Chancellor Goldsmith's advocacy and steadfastness to redress the disparities that our carceral impacted and justice involved students experience, we would not have the program. And by that, I mean, we wouldn't have written for and received funds over the past 2 years to have a program like the Rising Scholars Program. So I'm truly thankful to them. And I think it's an appropriate way to open up this symposium. We're very proud of this symposium. This is the second annual Rising Scholars Symposium. We did it last year. Our inaugural event was fully online. We were in the height of the pandemic and consequently we were not able to meet in person. Today's format, of course, you all know is a virtual format. Tomorrow's format will be in person on campus at Fresno City College. We truly hope that you can join us tomorrow if you're able to. If it's for a portion of the program or the entire program, we trust that you will have a meaningful learning experience engaging in conversations, workshops, presentations, and of course, one of my favorite parts of the symposium, the student panels. Please join us if you can tomorrow. I also have some good news that I am delighted and pleased to share with all of you. One of the reasons we're able to provide services that are unique to the Rising Scholars Program at Fresno City College is because of the generous support and funding that we receive from the California Community Colleges Chancellor's Office. And over the past 2 years, we received a grant to operate the Rising Scholars Program, which we also get to support and augment with our student equity funds. As previously noted by Dr. Pimentel, this program in focusing on carceral impacted and justice involved students is certainly part of our ongoing efforts to redress outcome disparities at the college. I'm pleased to report that the team wrote for and was awarded an additional $190,000 each year for the next 3 years through the Chancellor's Office Rising Scholars Network grant to continue providing services. What is more, and notably, Fresno City College is one of 50 colleges out of 116 community colleges in the state to receive these funds. Even more, Fresno City College received the largest award. Now, although that might be something to clap about, what that indicates is the need in the Fresno County and beyond service area that, Fresno City College provides services to, the need here in Fresno County in terms of individuals who are carceral impacted or justice involved or formerly incarcerated, the need here is great. In fact, perceivably, if you were to look at the grant applications and how they were scored, right, at the chancellor's office level, there are many factors that went into that. Ultimately, what we can assume with a high level of confidence is that the chancellor's office sees the need in the central San Joaquin Valley to provide better opportunities for justice involved and formerly incarcerated individuals and students. I'm excited about the opportunity ahead over the next 3 years. And that also means that we will continue to provide our Rising Scholar Symposium with multiple resources and funding streams. So although this is the second inaugural, I'm sorry, the second symposium, we will continue to have them over the next few years. Before I hand it off to our next speaker, Dr. Cassandra Little, I want to give my gratitude and thanks to the people who made this event possible. It was not me. As the Director of Student Equity and Success, I provide leadership and support. And all this, this is one of the programs that is in the Office of Equity and that I oversee. I need to give kudos to Celia and Martinez, Hugo, Susie, Dr. Cassandra Little, Victoria, our peer mentors in the Rising Scholars Program. Those are the people truly who made this event a reality and possible. And I'm in gratitude to them because this experience would not be possible without them coordinating and organizing everything. So I'm truly grateful for everyone. I'm especially grateful for Dr. Cassandra Little, who I get to introduce next. Dr. Cassandra Little has been by our side at Fresno City College and the Rising Scholars Program since its inception, since we started drafting the grant to the time we submitted it to the chancellor's office and received the funding, and has been our expert consultant and advisor throughout the entire time. More importantly, I consider her a colleague, a friend, a femtor, and someone I deeply trust and admire. And so with that, I want to turn it over to Dr. Cassandra Little. Thank you, Dr. Little, so much for everything you do, and thank you for being here.
Thank you, Ray and Robert. You know, I just have to thank both of you for even allowing me the opportunity. When I came to Central Valley 3 years ago, you know, no one knew who I was, and you all had opened your doors and allowed me to be a part of this vital program. As I've told you all from the beginning, to me, you know, education has been my savior in many ways. And so I'm a true believer in the power of education. So being a part of Rising Scholars has been incredible for me. With that being said, I just want to again say welcome to everyone to our second annual Rising Scholar Symposium. I'm very excited about today and tomorrow. And before we get started, I just wanted to take a short moment and say thank you to Fresno City College for you know, paving a path for students that have traditionally remained silent and, you know, out of shame and invisible. So whether they've been system impacted, whether they have family members or parents or even friends that have been impacted, you know, they have remained silent on many campuses. I also want to begin they are the reason why I, you know, put in, you know, I make myself available when the need sees fit. And so traditionally, you know, being labeled a formerly incarcerated or a system impacted community member would have put a scarlet letter on one's chest, right? Today, our rising scholars, I've had conversations with them where they're, you know, they're lobbying to get t-shirts to let everyone know on campus, to let them and you know, the administration know who they are, that they are, you know, they are impacted students, but they're there on campus. They're there to learn, and they're there to participate, and they're there to be successful. So I want to say to all the rising scholars, thank you all for not just being brave, because you are being brave, but being phenomenally present on campus. Now, to everyone, today you're going to hear some very inspirational and informative presenters. Like Ray said, last year was our first year, and it turned out better than any of us could ever expect it. I think it really resonated with me for, you know, days and days. So I'm promising you will leave here inspired and informed. You will leave after today and tomorrow wondering, like, okay, what just happened? And that's great. You know, I just want to say our goal is not to only provide you a space to learn and think over these past 2 days, but to feel. And, you know, and understand that as we bring you proximate to the joys, the angst and challenges of being system impacted or know someone who's system impacted and on college campus, we also want you to feel the humanness of the people who are, you know, who are on campus that are impacted. For me, I then want to ask, because I think it's important that we have an ask, that you develop your own plan of action to make a difference. And, you know, because what we do know, and I know in this space, that change and progress happens when we are collectively working together. And I know that can be challenging. I'm not being pretentious about that. I know that it can be challenging, but, I still want to have that ask. That you know, that no matter what race, gender, your identity, your religion, your political choice, or socioeconomic status, that's my ask, is that we can work collectively together to assist and encourage impacted students on college campuses. And my other ask is, if you don't want to, or if you don't feel like you can have an action plan, then just get out of the way. Simple. Don't create any barriers. That's an easy ask, right? And you know, I say that I have been very fortunate to be a part of the student equity department, and to be able to create a plan to create a productive and creative space for impacted students. And we're still, you know, we're still new, and we're still fleshing out some of those challenges, which I think is great. We know that there will always be bumps and bruises in this work. We also know that students from every situation on campus are worth the fight. I don't want, I'm an educator, so I understand that. But I also know that equity is different than equality, and equity is about leveling the playing field. And to keep that premise on the mindset of all folks in charge, we have to continue to have symposium like these and to elevate and support the voices of those who need us most. And during this symposium, it would be those students who are system impacted. And that's not taken away from other students. To me, it's an and, not a or. With that being said, you know, I just want to end by saying welcome, and I hope you take the opportunity to listen, to learn, and to engage. And also at the end of each process, please participate in the evaluation, and give us some feedback. All feedback is good feedback for us, and we just want you to take the ride, and at the end of the ride, like I said, come up with your own action plan. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Little. And with now that being covered with your thoughtful opening remarks and encouraging us and challenging us to be thoughtful in what we do and advocating for system impacted individuals, you certainly left us with a lot to think about throughout the symposium today and tomorrow as well. And so with that, I get to introduce Celia Martinez, who is my colleague in the Office of Equity and Student Success, and really the brains of everything we do and keeps everything and everyone together. So Celia, thank you. I'm gonna turn it over to you.
Good morning. It is my pleasure to introduce you to Glenn E. Martin, our keynote speaker for today. After exiting prison in New York State, Glenn E. Martin founded and directed a handful of national organizations in the nonprofit sector. Before becoming a multimillionaire by launching both GEM Real Estate and GEMtrainers, a multi-state real estate investment company and a successful nonprofit consultancy, respectively, Glenn founded and served as president of Just Leadership USA, an organization he built as a tribute to his son, Joshua, dedicated to cutting the U.S. correctional population in half by 2030. His leadership has been recognized with multiple honors, including the 2016 Robert F. Kennedy Human Rights Award and the 2017 Brooke Astor Award, and the 2014 Echoing Green Fellowship. Glenn has served as a public speaker and has been a media guest appearing on national news outlets such as NPR, MSNBC, Fox News, CNN, Al Jazeera, and C-SPAN. And now it's my pleasure to hand it over to Mr. Glenn E. Martin. Hi, Glenn, welcome.
Hi, Celia. Thank you for that really generous introduction. And thank you for the honor of serving as keynote today at the second annual Rising Scholars Student Symposium, Empowering and Elevating. I just want to say a quick congratulations to my fellow keynote and other distinguished speakers. Thank you to Dr. Pimentel for your words. Thank you to Dr. Little, a longstanding friend of mine. Thank you to the event organizers, and thank you to the people who helped sustain this program and make this opportunity a reality. And of course, congratulations to the Rising Scholar students. So I've been told that I have about an hour and 20 minutes. I am going to use the first hour to talk, though I can't think of anyone I'd like to listen to for an hour, myself included. I'll try to make it as dynamic as possible, but I will leave time on the back end for some Q&A. So I look forward to that. I believe that it's every person's responsibility to try and create the world you want to live in. We all have the ability and the responsibility to minister to the world in a way that can change it. That's my belief. And to minister radically in a genuine, active, practical, roll up your sleeves and be vulnerable sort of way. So I wrote my speech this morning with that sentiment in my heart and on my mind. But before I go any further, I'm sure some of you are like, who's this person that I'm listening to? I know sometimes when I hear a new speaker, I spend quite a bit of time asking myself why I should even be listening to this person. And I know also that in life, you should never fear telling your own story. You should actually fear people telling it for you. So a little bit about myself to offer some additional context for my statements this morning. I'm a disciplined entrepreneur. I do yoga a couple times a week. I work out three times a week. Love to go hiking, fishing, like to travel. I have a degree from Canisius College, which is a private Jesuit school in upstate New York. I live in a beautiful condo in New York City. I have a second home in Savannah and a vacation home in Tybee Island in Georgia. I spent 20 years working my way to the top of the nonprofit world. I've met with three presidents. I've raised over $100 million in philanthropic contributions. I have three amazing children. Armani, who's 26, he's a US Marine. Joshua and son Saray, who are 11 and 6, respectively. And both attend one of the most prestigious private schools in New Jersey. I recently founded and run a successful nonprofit consultancy business with clients from across the United States. I have 9 subcontractors, and we've raised over $30 million for our nonprofit clients over the last 4 years. I also founded and served as managing partner and sole member for 4 real estate investment LLCs with 94 properties in total and over $10 million in equity. So that was the like throw up in your mouth, highly curated and perfectly branded version of my life. In a world of social media and TikTok videos and 240 character tweets and media cycles that move at the speed of light, that description kind of works. In real life, it's a romanticized version of a much more complex human being. So let me take another shot at that. I'm a person who has failed his way to success. I'm a person who believes that the journey, not the destination, is what's most important. I believe that each of us are capable of amazingly virtuous and tremendously immoral behavior. But I don't believe in good people and bad people. As the Russian dissident Alexander Solzhenitsyn once said, the line between separating good and evil passes not through states, nor between classes, nor between political parties either, but right through every human heart. I've accepted that duality as a way to shape and be comfortable with my own identity, as well as an opportunity to show grace for others. Lastly, I've learned that personal character is primarily built when you're in the valley, not when you're on the mountaintop. Friends are better identified in the darkness and not in the sunlight. And every single setback is a setup for a comeback. So here's the fuller version of my story, the good, the bad, and the ugly. I'm the son of an immigrant, single mom, who emigrated from Grenada in the Caribbean and who was born in St. Kitts, a Black woman. My dad is a Brit, a former military officer and police chief. He's always lived in the Caribbean with all of the privilege of a colonizer, a white man. I have 2 brothers, Sheldon, my older brother, and Adam, my younger brother. We moved from Grenada to Bedford Stuyvesant Brooklyn in 1980, middle of the winter, and I had never seen snow, and immediately thought of the US as being cold and white, the irony. As a Black immigrant, my mom moved through multiple low wage, high turnover, no fringe benefits jobs, mostly cleaning the homes of wealthy white people on the Upper West and Upper East Sides of Manhattan. We were on and off public assistance, and we used the hospital emergency room as our primary care provider. I was a mediocre student living with a crisis of identity, very confusing melanin-deprived skin, living in the middle of Bed-Stuy, where most people were dark-skinned Black Americans, with a Caribbean accent that I couldn't really explain to people, but with a tremendous amount of emotional intelligence and a bunch of C-plus grades in class. While my dad occasionally would visit the United States, I don't think he ever really visited to spend time with us. After his first summer in the States, he quickly developed a friendship with a local store owner, which led to a seasonal job for him. On one visit, he asked me to take his name. It's one of the first memories I remember of rage, just sheer rage. Why would I take his last name when we were suffering in Bed-Stuy alone, when my mom was the one struggling to raise me and my brothers? Every summer after that, he'd visit the United States to work for his friend, visit me once or twice, and then buy me a cheap pair of sneakers and a coat before he departed back to Grenada. Beyond that, he was a ghost. One summer, he set his mind to visiting the local police precinct. He wanted to meet his law enforcement counterparts. On a Saturday morning, he excitedly asked Sheldon and me if we wanted to tag along. My mom urged us to spend time with him, as she always had. But Sheldon said he had a basketball game to attend, which left me stuck to deal with this walk of shame. I recall walking the 4 blocks to the 71st precinct from my home with him as he yanked me along with his right hand and clutched his police badge in his left. Brooklyn's police precincts were, and still are, built like fortresses, a really like their granite facades, a thin gray line between the community and the horrors of our criminal justice system. And back then, most of the officers were white, and they only spoke to you when they were searching you or making an arrest. They call you nigger or spick. They demand, as they drove by in their cruisers, that you use your scrawny little black body to hold the water back from the gushing hydrants that we'd play in to fend off the summer heat. They'd drive by really slowly, give you a scornful look that sort of said, I dare you to let me get wet. God forbid they'd just roll up their windows and leave us alone. When we arrived at the precinct, my father opened the large metal doors, flashed his police badge at the shift commander, and asked whether he and I could have a tour of the precinct. How many black folks request tours of a freaking police precinct? Before long, the officers and detectives were passing his badge around, giving him an NYPD cap to take home, and joking about their most memorable arrests. I was the only black face in the room, but for most of that visit, I felt invisible. Before we left, my dad asked me to sit inside one of the holding cells for a photograph. I walked into the cell and, afraid they would shut and lock the gate behind me, sat as close to the entrance as possible. My father lifted his Polaroid camera and snapped a pic of me sitting in that small dark cell, my face pressed up against the cold gray bars. On the walk home, he couldn't have been happier with that stupid ass NYPD baseball cap on his head. I didn't say a word. I couldn't wait to scrub my face and hands and forget that experience ever happened. But it would end up being one of the most eerie foreshadowings of my life. Eventually, as latchkey kids, the allure of the streets became way too intoxicating. And I was arrested at the age of 16 and charged with shoplifting at Macy's department store in Midtown Manhattan. And up until about 6 years ago, if you were charged at age 16 in New York, you were charged as an adult automatically. Because the arresting officer didn't actually find any merchandise on my person, he got super angry and eventually kicked me down a flight of stairs. That evening, I still got arrested and put through the system. And I got put in front of this arraignment judge. This judge sitting on high, on his big mahogany desk with his silly little black robe and his white justice, looked over the rim of his Ralph Lauren glasses and gave me $1,500 bail for shoplifting. Said he wanted to teach me a lesson. It might as well have been $15 million, because if you're poor and you get $1,500, you know what you do with it? You spend it. And so it wasn't bail for me, it was ransom, that $1,500. So he definitely was about to teach me a lesson. So I ended up on Rikers Island, a place that doesn't need a lot of explaining for most people. It was called Gladiator School. It's still called Gladiator School. You have two choices there, then and now, predator or prey. The judge scheduled my follow-up hearing for just 72 hours later, 3 days later. So there was little time to actually acclimate to Rikers. 3 days later, I found myself back in the facility's intake area holding cells. On court dates, the correction officers wake you up at 4:30 a.m. and they do it by banging their nightsticks on the metal bars of the cell. Even though you might not see the judge until 3 p.m. that day, you were lucky to stand in front of the judge for 2 or 3 minutes, but you were up at 4:30 in the morning. They'd move you through 7 to 10 cells between Rikers and the courts on a court day, a process intended clearly to break you down and prepare you to accept a plea deal, which is how 90% of cases in the United States are resolved anyhow. When it came to Rikers, punishment is definitely in the process. So no matter what happened in court, by the time you got there, you were already scarred, especially as a 16-year-old, as a child, as someone with a brain that's not fully developed yet. As I sat in the holding cell with 25 other kids, because we were all kids, trying to decide whether I should eat that morning's box of Wheaties, one of the guys in the cell approached me. He was about 5'11", had on this expensive Adidas sweatsuit and a mouthful of gold teeth, put his hands to his lips, gesturing for me to be quiet. He told me to stand up. And then he said, give me your motherfucking jacket. My mouth suddenly went dry. I could feel my leg muscles tighten. I could feel my knuckles turning white as I balled them into a fist. And before he pronounced the word jacket, I punched him in the face and jumped on top of him. Predator or prey? Those were the choices for a 16-year-old detainee at Rikers. Within seconds, the cell just erupted as four or five other boys jumped on top of me and began kicking and throwing punches. I quickly realized I was being jumped, but my adrenaline was rushing and I felt superhuman in the moment. I got hit a few times, yeah, but I didn't feel the pain. For the first time in my life, I actually felt like a man, or what I thought was a man at the time. Discovering the courage to swing first and then continue to swing gave me an indescribable rush of pride and satisfaction. Rikers was a Black boy's bar mitzvah. It was my journey into manhood. My strategy was to keep my face hidden and try to beat the shit out of at least one of them to get the others to back off. I knew that if they got one good hit on me, all bets were off though. I think it was Mike Tyson who once said, everyone has a plan till you get punched in the mouth. Honestly, I would have welcomed a punch in the mouth compared to what happened next. As I was struggling to defend myself and stay on my feet, I felt this sharp pain in my lower back. And then I noticed blood rolling down my face from the back of my head. Before I could fully comprehend what was happening, the kid who had first stepped to me reached up and stabbed me in the left side of my neck with a pen that he had melted and sharpened into a dagger. I can still feel the scar tissue from that. He left the pen hanging in my neck, so I had to pull it from my skin and simultaneously avoid the correction officers who were now rushing into the cell. I was scared they were gonna whoop my ass, but they pulled me from the cell and broke us all up into three different holding cells. And the roughest part of the whole experience, the most degrading part, actually came next. The correction officers put me in a cell alone, handed me a roll of paper towels. One of them asked me whether I wanted to file a complaint, but immediately reminded me that I'd be labeled as a snitch and face repercussions. He told me that if I didn't make an official complaint and identify the dude who came at me, however, I could not have access to medical staff. Choices. I remember feeling a crazy sense of resentment in that moment. I chose to keep my mouth shut because I wanted to go to court that day. And besides, I actually felt satisfied. I might've been beat up and bleeding, but I put myself in Gladiator School's dean list that day. That judge wanted to teach me a lesson, and he did, that I was tough enough to survive Rikers. Fuck him. When I got to court later that day, my public defender told the judge that I had been, quote, beaten up on Rikers to explain the blood all over my shirt. Part of me resented him for not saying that I won that fight. Bastard. It was a different judge this time, though, and he seemed apathetic to my dilemma, but he released me with no bail and told me to stay out of trouble till my next court date. I left my stint on Rikers with stab wounds on my neck, my lower back, and the back of my head, and what felt like an invitation into an adulthood full of pain and suffering. I hoped to never return, but I knew if I did, I could survive. So whatever the mission of Rikers in the abstract, I quickly learned that the only concrete policy was to make a virtue of cruelty and a vice of compassion on Rikers. Maybe there's a parallel world out there where I was never there in the first place. But in this world, a combination of my own screw ups and the gravitational pull of life would see to it that in the coming years, it would be a numbing loop of crime and short-term incarceration. Rinse, repeat, rinse, repeat. My experience at Rikers helped shape the world for me at an early age, including how I fit into it. As a child, a 16-year-old, the world around me became cold, isolating, full of danger, and required me to calcify and fight. I learned that emotions were problematic and hypermasculinity was celebrated. I went back to my hood to become better at what I was doing. I moved out of my mom's crib after that stint at Rikers, and the streets became my guardian. Shoplifting turned into robberies. Robberies turned into armed robberies. ultimately, I graduated to jewelry store robberies, had cars and motorcycles and apartments and jewelry, and I partied hard and we smoked weed and saw many of my friends get killed or sent to prison. I always knew one day things would come to a grinding halt, though. Either I'd be dead or I'd be locked up. We all knew that. And then it happened. At age 23, I was arrested for 5 charges of armed robbery and 89 counts. My first offer was 20 to 40. That was the plea deal. So I was back at Rikers, except this time I knew what to expect, predator or prey. After a year on Rikers, the case got stale for the prosecutor, and my lawyer built up a relationship with the judge, and I took a plea, and I was sentenced to 9 years. I had a year in, so I figured I'd do another 2 or 3 and then get back home to become better at what I was doing. I ended up doing 6 years. As I entered state prison, I stepped into a cold, dark cell one day at Auburn Correctional Facility in New York. So when you leave Rikers and you get sentenced, you get sent to state prison, which is usually hours and hours away from New York City. And as I stepped into the cell, I quickly realized that I wasn't alone. So this was transit. This wasn't the permanent facility. So I didn't have any of my stuff with me, no bags, no clothes, no utensils, no nothing. And on the bottom bunk, buried inside of a shadow, sat a man just murmuring to himself. Because in New York, we had locked up so many people that all the cells were double bunked. And when you're trapped in an 8 by 10 foot space with a stranger, especially one who talks to himself, the human mind kicks into 5th gear. I said, "What's up?" in my deepest voice. He said, "What's up? My name is Arthur." Within 30 minutes, I learned that he had been in prison since he was 16 and had served 17 years. He was only 33 years old, but he had gray hair and ruddy skin and tired eyes. Arthur had grown up in the South Bronx, where the family business of selling drugs made for an awkward partner with the family vice of using drugs. He shared stories of his dad cutting up cocaine in the kitchen when he was 10 years old. At age 10, he started smoking cigarettes at first and then weed by age 12. By 13, he was selling dime bags. By 15, he was smoking and selling crack. By age 16, he was arrested under New York State's Rockefeller drug laws for possession of cocaine, staring down 25 years of a mandatory minimum prison time. At age 16, still a child, he and what he was still referring to as his, quote, shitty lawyer, rolled the dice and went to trial. He would quickly regret not taking the plea of 10 years. He was found guilty of possession and received a full 25-year sentence, an abyss from which there's no guarantee of safe return. So listening to Arthur recount the details of his story sent me down the memory hole of my own. Arthur and I talked endlessly that weekend, with our conversation occasionally punctuated by this correction officer making his rounds and doing what? Banging his nightstick on the cells. It's an obnoxious reminder of who's in charge. At Auburn, the CEOs kept the old gray windows open all night, allowing the frigid winter air to bring the temperature in the cell block down to just above freezing. By 9 p.m. on the first night, I was freezing and I felt a sore throat start to develop. I knew my body well enough to know I was late, it was too late for wishful thinking. I had caught a cold. I began to sneeze and quickly ran through a roll of toilet tissue. To help me, Arthur said, "You should really take some of my medication," and handed me his Thorazine. Yeah, nah. He then followed up with what felt like an even more extraordinary offer. Arthur said to me, quote, "Would you like a cup of tea?" Arthur asked this as if he was as simple as, "I'm going to go close the window." And ordinarily, it would be, but this was prison. So I decided to just play along. "Yeah, Arthur, a cup of tea would be great. I'll grab some biscuits from the cupboard." I was certain that he was about to pull out an imaginary kettle. But instead, he jumped up from the bunk, pulled me into this fray with him, and deputized me as his eyes and ears with the task of looking out for the CEO while he set himself to shattering my sense of possibility. Arthur first filled an empty plastic bottle with water from the sink. He then tied a string from the neck of the bottle to the broken light fixture above the bed. By now, my disbelief was swallowed by fascination. Arthur pulled away the mattress that exposed the gray metal bed frame, grabbed a roll of toilet tissue, and spun the tissue tightly to create a wick. He then used an electric outlet and a lead pencil to light the tissue on fire. And as the bottle hovered above the flame, spinning, it shrunk from the heat, but it didn't burst. Instead, it brought the water to a steady boil. And then Arthur peeled the stitching of his prison uniform collar to reveal two tea bags that he had hidden there. And he placed one of them in the bottle and handed me tea. I felt a small tremor of shame for even doubting him in the first place, for having internally mocked the whole affair as like some waking fantasy just a minute ago. It was one of those moments you remember with staggering clarity. One of those moments that mark a point in time when the world shifts beneath you, when the foundations of the old order and its unshakable wisdom begin to crumble just as the new one begins to take shape. As is probably happening for many of the students now, I still search for those moments every day. I search for moments that allow me to let go of what my reality was just yesterday. Arthur couldn't have possibly known this episode of basic resourcefulness on his part would so radically impact my world. But how could it not? I had just watched what felt like mysticism, though I know it was an extraordinary display of hard-won human ingenuity. I tell that story over and over again, and I hold it really closely because Arthur's story is the story of millions of us, each with their own world of unique experiences and revolving around a single gravitational force, mass incarceration, and the way it not only cages human bodies, but the genius and spirit of innovation that lives in each of us. We lock up America's best and brightest. Arthur was the victim of a system that was built to crush his spirit, steal his hopes, and eradicate his dreams. Here's a person in our criminal justice system who finds compassion in the middle of that moment for a stranger fighting off a cold, who, through sheer force of will, whittles away at the wicked machinery of the system, which is meant to reduce people like him to human rubble. A system forged in the fires of punishment and retribution, and that churns out a tremendous amount of human carnage. Arthur found the courage to exercise that compassion in a place where the expression of emotion can be a death sentence. And he exercised the brilliance that we honor and reward in many other arenas, reminding us that necessity is the mother of invention. Arthur taught me humility, love, courage, and compassion in that cold, dark cell that weekend. So hang on to that for a moment. Arthur could be the most bitter person in the world, but let's assume you don't have compassion for Arthur. Maybe you believe deeply in the wisdom of that old cliche about crime and time. He broke the social contract and is therefore right where he ought to be. So let's retrace the incredible events that I described and try to situate them in a larger landscape. Here's a man who made tea for me in a prison cell. He used a plastic bottle, a string, toilet paper, and a pencil. This is by the lights of any sober person's thinking, a feat of remarkable innovation. In the economic parlance, in the entrepreneurship parlance, Arthur would be said to have tapped into his dormant and highly valuable human capital. What happens to that extraordinary potential? Not only of Arthur, but of the 70 million Americans who also bear the scarlet letter of a criminal record. Whether you've served a day or 40 years in prison is secondary in this way. That record is a life sentence because the stigma of a criminal record is meant to stay with you for the remainder of your waking days. Is this the America that we preach about to the rest of the world, the land of second chances, where anyone can reinvent themselves with the proper dosage of self-reliance? When it comes to the formerly incarcerated, it seems like the myth of meritocracy begins to crumble upon the slightest inspection. Arthur taught me that when you live in the slow, ceaseless churn of legal cruelty, a part of you can learn how to make hell feel like home, that in the darkest spaces, you can still create community, and that doing so requires grit and creativity, values that in most other arenas we honor and reward. Arthur taught me to err in the direction of kindness. So eventually I was moved to a permanent facility. I was sent up to Attica. And when I got there, I was taking a test to try to figure out what kind of job I would get while I was in prison. And the correction counselor who was testing maybe 400 people that day took a minute at the end of the test and he walked over to me and he put his hand on my shoulder and he leaned over and said, he said, "Wow, your grades are amazing. You should go to college." And I thought he was being sarcastic. I mean, this was one of the lowest moments in my life. I didn't think there was opportunity to do much of anything here except mourn. And he said, "You should go to college." And he said, "There's a college program here." And it was the first time anyone had ever said that to me. And, you know, I look back on it now and maybe I romanticized the moment. But what that moment taught me was a couple of things. One, who would expect any good to come from a correctional system? Who would expect a correction counselor to be the one to tell me to go to college? There were so many other human beings in my life before then who could have told me to do the same. The other thing it taught me is that, particularly with young people, but with all human beings, there's always a chance to plant a seed that grows into a tree that you may never enjoy the shade of. If I met that correctional counselor today, if I sat next to him on the subway, I wouldn't recognize him. But he planted a seed that day that got me all the way to the White House, that got me to a family, that got me to wealth, that got me to compassion for other people and for myself, that got me to healing. And it wasn't the college degree as a credential. That's part of it. But it was all the other things that we know happens when you're in an educational setting. The relationships, the experiences, the camaraderie, the conversations, the thought partnership, the projects we do together. Yeah, at the beginning I said I graduated from Canisius College. I did. I was sitting in a prison cell. It was 22 years ago, and I earned a quality liberal arts degree. 22 years after my own graduation, I've come gradually to understand that the liberal arts cliche about teaching you how to think is actually shorthand for something that's much more, much deeper and much more serious. Learning how to think really means learning how to exercise control over how and what you think. It means being conscious and aware enough to choose what you pay attention to and to choose how you construct meaning from experience. Because if you can't exercise this kind of choice in life, you'll be stuck in an endless cycle of poor decision-making and consequences. And we live in a country with a criminal justice system that lacks parsimony and proportionality and social justice and restoration. I'll never forget when I was exiting prison in 2000, the deputy warden of the correctional facility said to me, half jokingly, "You help me get my boat, and when your son gets here, he'll help my son get his boat." At that point, I was done with the conversation, though today I realize I can't thank that deputy enough for his blunt honesty, for laying bare in one sentence the core of America's prison industrial complex, for giving my children the best chance of never helping his child buy his boat. Even with all of the suffering and pain I've described, I've found that my journey has been incredibly liberating for me, because no matter what happened, I had the peace of mind knowing that all of the difficult moments, the name calling, the doubting, all of it was just noise. Ultimately, it didn't define me. It didn't change who I was. And most importantly, it couldn't hold me back. You're all on a similar journey. All human beings are. But some of us remain stuck in a tiny rearview mirror and we miss what's in the windshield on the horizon. The opportunity to heal from the past and shape our own futures. The ability to recognize failure as the foundation upon which success is built. I'm not naive. I know we live in an unfair world that's increasingly tribal, in a country that was built on white supremacy, in a world filled with war and hunger and despair and disease. The weight of those realities can't be minimized, but I also know that each of us has the ability to wake up every day and make choices about how we move through that world, how we minister to the world, choices about how much darkness we cause, choices about how much light we bring. And as Arthur taught me, we can choose to err in the direction of kindness and creativity, even in the darkest situations. God bless you, and thanks for listening. And if there's time, I'd love to take some questions.
Wow, Glenn, thank you so much for sharing and imparting some of your experience and journey, as I will call it, as you describe with us. And and the colleagues, friends, community partners, and people in the audience to say your message is powerful is not sufficient enough to describe how moving it was. So thank you so much for that.
Thank you for the kind words. Thank you.
Absolutely. And so what I want to do now is just remind everyone in the audience is if you have a question for Glenn Martin, you can put your question in the Q&A feature of Zoom. We prefer that you use the Q&A feature in Zoom. It allows us on the back end to monitor and keep track of those questions that you're posing. Or you can also use the chat feature as well. I've seen a couple of folks do that. So Glenn, we do have a couple questions so far. You're getting some powerful, definitely kudos comments in the chat. Just wanted to throw that out there, of course. But one of the first questions we have, it says, Mr. Martin, amazing story about creativity and resourcefulness. I'm wondering how many individuals you met that you feel maybe shouldn't have been in prison, but were simply a victim of circumstances.
Yeah, thanks for that question. First of all, thanks for the kind words and thanks for the question. And, you know, coming from a focus group of one, me, I feel confident that about 80% of the people I met in prison could have been in some alternate opportunity or just home with no form of punishment. I did meet some people who I thought needed a deeper level of support and services. Our criminal justice system operates as a surrogate for our lack of a robust mental health system in this country. And that's unfortunate. And that's a real sad state of affairs. But they were, I'd say, about 20% of people who had serious and persistent mental illness that needed a deeper level of support. But I found that they were a tremendous amount of people who literally could not be tethered to any part of our criminal justice system and still be hugely successful. I met people in prison, I'd say the majority of them, who I literally would allow to babysit my children. And I say that on purpose. I speak with the sharp end of the axe when I'm talking about the people I met in prison, because here I am 51 years old and I have found that some of the most resilient, intelligent, creative, trustworthy people I've ever met were the people I met during those 6 years while I was incarcerated.
Wow. You know, gosh, you got me thinking about this. There's this quote that one of my mentors uses often, and quoting someone else, right? And I might be paraphrasing this incorrectly, but I think the content is what matters, right? And it's that every system is designed to achieve the results it gets, right? And so when you're describing, for example, like our health system, right? And from like a systems perspective, I just think about many of the other public services, if you will, right? And just structures in general in our society, right? You also eloquently and thoughtfully affirmed and acknowledged how many of the systems and structures that we interact with throughout society, right? During your speaking points is that it's predicated on white supremacy, right? And the residual effects of yesteryear and what continues to manifest in different ways now continues to have an influence on those systems, right? So powerful.
So I'm glad you brought up multiple other systems, because there are many people in America who would say, yeah, 70 million people have a criminal record on file, but that's not me. And I've never been arrested and I don't have to deal with mass incarceration. And if you stay out of trouble, you don't have to deal with it, except I would argue that we've generally just become a very punitive country, period. And that's why when you walk into public schools, you walk through metal detectors and you walk past police officers. That's why when you try to use your insurance, if you use it incorrectly, you get penalized. Like, think of how many places in your life where if you don't accomplish something, the response is not compassion and support, it is punitiveness. And so the more we allow our criminal justice system to operate the way it does, is the more the poison of that system leaks into other areas of our lives. And I think a huge part of it is that our culture has leaned heavily towards who do we accuse, who do we punish, and then how do we move on?
No doubt about it. So I'm going to go ahead and transition. We have a few more questions and we have a little bit of time. So I'm going to transition to some other questions. This question comes from one of our wonderful students. All of our students are wonderful, but I wanted to emphasize this is from a student. And the question is, can you touch upon the word you used, quote, resilient, end quote? Where were you mentally during those times?
That's a really good question. I love people who ask questions that allow leaders to talk about how they were actually feeling in a moment, as opposed to something more transactional. So great question. Glad it came from a student. Fear. So I want to say that out loud. I'm not fearless. I get scared. There are moments, there have been times in my life where I've suffered from depression and was too scared to even put my feet on the floor. And having said that, I probably, because of how difficult my life has been and how many ups and downs I've experienced and how many people around me I've seen go through suffering and then prevail, like that has become my go-to for faith in the moments where I'm fearful. So I don't want to diminish the fact that in those moments where I'm seeking resilience and the ability to get back on my feet, I am fearful. But what I find is that with experience, I recognize that there is an opportunity to, at the very least, put one foot in front of the other, even when you can't see the ground in front of you. And that almost always, there is at least one or two people, there are at least one of two people around you that are willing to take that journey with you. I don't believe that large numbers of people will. Like, I think social media and everything else in the world today gives us the false notion that we're loved by so many people. But I do believe that if you're willing to open your heart and be vulnerable, that there's an opportunity to have people take that journey with you and help you get to the point of resilience, even in the moment. In fact, mostly in the moment when you're suffering. I said it during my talk that you will identify the people who love and care about you the most and will walk with you towards resilience in your darkest moments when you're in the valley.
Wow. I don't know about others in the audience, but you got me in the feels with that comment. I mean, that response, you really do. Particularly like your thoughtful response about like open your heart and be vulnerable, right? I have the privilege of facilitating, as I call it, right? And leading institution-wide racial equity, diversity, inclusion, anti-racism efforts with colleagues, right? And often what I tell colleagues here in our institution and in the community and people I work with is that it's heart work, right? And it takes a heart set, not just a mindset, to do the work. And so when you speak so passionately, thoughtfully about opening up your heart, it resonates with me. And I invite others in the audience to think about how you might be able to open up your heart and be vulnerable, and even thinking about your heart set and that mindset, right? So thank you so much for that. We'll transition to some more questions because we got some coming in. So this is short, and I'm curious as well, although I know the answer, but I want to know more. So Glenn, have you written a book telling your story?
I didn't see that question coming. I thought it was another question you were going to say. I was so prepared to say, what do I do today? Because I saw that question from Dr. Pimentel. Have I written a book? Writing a book is easy. I've been writing it for the last 12 years. I've had some dark moments over the past 20 years, but definitely over the past few years. And I really did sit down and write a couple hundred pages of a book. And then I got to the finish line, or at least what felt like the finish line, and realized that the book was for me and not for anyone else, at least in this moment. That writing the book was cathartic. It helped me to process a lot of the pain I've gone through, but also the pain I've caused other people. The many, many conversations I had to have with family and friends and maybe even enemies. Actually, the journey was more important than the destination. I'm glad you gave me a chance to say that again. So yes, I've written a book and it sits on my desktop, on my MacBook. And one day maybe I'll feel confident that it's done and that there's a lesson there for the rest of you. But selfishly, the book I have now, the lessons there were for me.
Thank you so much for that. Well, since that was a good segue, let's go ahead and go on to that next question that you already pointed out from Dr. Pimentel, simply asking, What do you currently do today?
Great, I appreciate that question. So I have learned so much in the nonprofit space, particularly one of the strongest skills, fundraising, that I decided to create this nonprofit consultancy that helps all sorts of other, particularly criminal justice and community violence intervention related nonprofits run by mostly directly impacted people, because anyone who knows me knows that I believe people closest to the problem are closest to the solution, but furthest from power and resources. And so my nonprofit consultancy helps to move those very people from the margins to the center, closer to power, closer to resources. So I'm really proud of that work. Also because it allows me to support the movement from a very different vantage point than I have in the past, and to be able to invest in leaders whose values really match my own. So that's half my life. The other half of my life is real estate. I decided a few years ago that if you're going to be a tenacious advocate, that you cannot deny that there's an importance of having multiple streams of income, because in this country, when people come for you, they come for your income. Because why? Because we have so much tied to our employment in this country, healthcare, retirement, income, et cetera, et cetera. And so I decided to get into real estate, and I didn't know what the heck I was doing. I was scared to death. And I just started buying a house or two here and there. And I was using the traditional model of buying a house, going through a bank and so on. And I was like, this doesn't feel like real estate. This doesn't feel like I'm going to get rich quickly. What's going on here? And then one day I was on Twitter and I was being vulnerable and pretty much saying the same things I'm saying to you guys. And a guy said to me, hey, I'd love to talk to you about real estate. I'm formerly incarcerated too. In fact, I just got out of federal prison and I'm sitting at home on house arrest. And I said, sure, let's have a conversation. I try to make myself super accessible to people. And we get on the phone and I'm talking to him, and he spends, I don't know, 40 out of the 60 minutes talking about how depressed he was and how listening to a formerly incarcerated person speak so boldly about his prison experience and what he's been doing since then actually gave him hope. And that was super inspiring to me. But then toward the end of the conversation, he said, yeah, before I went to prison, I was making $100,000 a month in real estate. So that obviously caught my attention also. And I decided to hire him as an advisor. And I'll tell you, the funny part of the story is so many people around me, as I started telling them about this guy I met on Twitter who had 46 followers, who's on house arrest, who I'm now going to work closely with and give all my credit cards to and all my personal information and so on. A lot of people around me said, you're crazy. I wouldn't trust him. I wouldn't trust him. Nope. I wouldn't give him my credit. I wouldn't trust. And I said, how can I go through the world telling people they need to trust Black men and not trust a Black man? I said, I have to. And I did. And yesterday I closed on 39 houses in one day because of this man. That's what got me to 94 properties. Yesterday I closed on 39 in one day. And when I met him, I had 9 properties. And this is only 17 months ago. And that's the author's story all over again, right? So anyway, to answer your question, I spend the other half of my life in real estate development, but what I also do is I bring my social justice lens to it, and I rent about 90% of my properties to people on Section 8 and people who are formerly incarcerated very deliberately in the South, in Birmingham, Montgomery, and Savannah, Georgia.
That's beautiful. I don't know what to say about that. I mean, it's beautiful, your social justice consciousness, and it's not just a benefit to you, but you're thinking about community and those who share similar experiences. And like I have this saying, right? If not me, then who? If not us, then who? Right? Or if not now, then when? Right? And so I think about the properties you have, and you're not just leasing and renting to general population of people. You're intentional and you're thoughtful about providing opportunities that otherwise would not probably be possible, right?
And then bragging about it on social media on purpose so people can really challenge me and I can generate conversations about why I do what I do. Yes.
That is beautiful. And there's where the magic happens when people are having a dialogue about why, right? Or why not.
Yes.
Thank you. So Glenn, we have a couple more questions here in the chat I want to pose to you. And so this next one reads, if you could speak to the counselor who initiated your academic journey, what would you say?
You know, that story is so romantic. I don't want to meet the person and be disappointed, but I don't want him to say, you know, I was just having a bad day that day. Normally I don't talk to inmates, but anyway, I'd love to hold on to my romanticized story of this. I would probably use the word love in that conversation and tell that person that I really have a lot of love and respect for them for taking time out of their lives to really invest in me at a time when the vision they saw for me, I couldn't even see for myself. But I'll also tell them about how often since then that I've tried to do that for other people. Like I have a lot of people today who are on amazing journeys where when they first came to me, they were sort of bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, didn't have the resources, barely had the idea fully formulated. I'm a big believer in leaping and building the wings on your way down and then soaring from there. And so when, you know, I tell people, if you wait to get all the way to the point where everything is in place, if you wait for perfect to be the enemy of the good, you're probably not going to do some of the most amazing things that you have the capability and potential to do. And so I would tell that person that they taught me that lesson, if not in that moment, definitely years later. And how much, I guess, if you think of the butterfly effect, how much their investment in me has gone on to really be an opportunity for many, many other people who I've come into contact with.
I really appreciate what you said about how they invested in you. And again, thinking back about how you're investing in carceral impacted individuals, right? You're investing in them. And it seems like this, thinking back to the question that was posed, right? So someone invested in you because they saw something good in you. They saw the tenacity of you and the ability of you rising despite circumstances, right? And it makes me think about the colleagues we have here on campus, right? We have counselors on campus, right? And colleagues like Mark McNiff is someone, I'll throw a name out, comes to mind, right? Who's really been doing this work that we're talking about in Rising Scholars long before I even came to the college in 2012, right? And it's people like that who use their position of influence and agency to invest in the most marginalized, right? And I think it's truly wonderful how you talk about your experience and your journey to how far you have come and successful, quite frankly, right? You talked a little bit about that earlier, your success. But even so, you're investing in those most marginalized and pushed to the outside of society, right? And with that, I want to encourage those in audience, particularly those if you work at the college or you're one of our partners from another university, and you know, riding on the coattails of what Dr. Little said, is how can you create change and better opportunities for system impact and carceral involved individuals? So with that, we'll transition to our last two questions here. Got some great questions, Glenn. I'm curious about the experiences of your siblings. Did they endure the same type of challenges that you survived? Where are they now?
So thanks for that. let's talk about my younger brother first, Adam. Yes, he went in and out of jail. So my older brother went into the military when he was 17, the Navy. That changed the trajectory of his life. I'll talk about him in a second. My younger brother and I stayed in Bedford Stuyvesant Brooklyn and got in trouble, got arrested. He went the area of selling drugs. I went the area of robberies, and we both went in and out of jail over and over. Today, he's doing well. He has a job. He has a degree as a licensed electrician. Just hung out with him the other day. We ate cupcakes together and ate food together on Easter and had a good time. And I feel blessed because Black men typically don't have that opportunity to grow up with their brothers. They're either in jail or dead. And so I'm glad that all three of us are adult men doing well. My older brother, after he went into the military, he became a federal correction officer. And now he's a US Marshal. And so Thanksgivings at my family home are really interesting. But look, I'll say this, you know, the beauty of having a father who worked in law enforcement, a brother who grew up to go into law enforcement, a white father, a Black mother, a Caribbean background, like those things leave me very open to judging people based on their character and not putting them into boxes. If you're going to do criminal justice reform work in a country like America, where you need large amounts of consensus to make anything happen, drawing a thick line in the sand around your political stance or other types of ways that we tend to tribalize ourselves actually gets in the way of helping people to recognize your humanity and the humanity of people you might be advocating for. And on an issue where we've gone so far down the road of punitiveness because we've dehumanized so many people, we have to continue to create spaces for those very people to become human again. And that takes us not drawing these thick lines in the sand, instead creating moments for us to learn from each other and recognize something in someone else that reminds you of your own humanity, your own fallibility, your own sort of ability to be great, all of those things. But that only happens with proximity.
No doubt about it. And thank you for just, you know, sharing more about your siblings and your family in general, and trusting in us, right? I know that was a important question to whoever asked that, and it was a thoughtful response. So on to our next question here. This is from a student as well. I think it's important to note that questions, when they come from students, just to center that into this space that we're all in right now. What advice would you give for someone aspiring to be a leader for change as well?
I'm going to answer that question, and I'm not going to let us get off the call unless you also ask Dr. Little's question afterwards. So I'll make it work. Here's what I would say to leaders. Here's what I say to all leaders around me, because it's something I learned about 15 years ago, and I've continued to try to practice. There are three principles that really guide my decision making. And when I use them and run challenges through that filter, I'm usually very successful. And when I forget to use them, I get myself in trouble. And so the first thing I would say is, I believe leaders live in conflict. That if you wake up in the morning and you're experiencing conflict in life, it's exactly where you belong. That's where leaders belong. Leaders choose to be the ones that people come to with their conflicts. And leaders are the ones that take on the responsibility of helping to coach people through those things. But there's three principles that guide my decision-making, particularly in conflict and crises. One, responsibility. How do you take responsibility for whatever situation is transpiring and whatever's going on between you and another human being? Why? Because that is the only thing you have any control over. Like, you cannot change other people's behaviors. What you can do is to figure out, what role are you playing in the dynamic between you and that person? Or what role are you playing in a process that's not going well? So it's a very empowering place to come from. Number two, self-reflection and feedback. That leaders should spend a tremendous amount of time being self-reflective about how they're showing up as a leader, but also surround yourself with two or three or four people who you believe are invested in your leadership and ask them for feedback. And then when they give it to you, say, thank you. Is there anything else? And don't respond to the feedback. Don't explain it. Don't try to push it away from you. Just say, thank you. Is there anything else? So that they understand that you're actually committed to hearing their feedback. And then lastly, creating collective leadership. That you don't have to try to emulate other leaders, because often you'll get it wrong anyhow, because what you think you see is your version, your interpretation of how that leader is showing up. Most leaders are spending a tremendous amount of time investing in the leadership of other people, other leaders. And if you spend the majority of your time there, you will emerge as an extremely strong leader yourself.
Wow. Thank you for that question. I'm over here taking notes in general, but I'm highlighting now. There's some profound implications, I think, for anyone who is interested or also curious about leadership or currently in a leadership role. Thank you for that. So we have a couple more questions. We have one more in our queue in a chat feature, and then we have a question in the chat from Dr. Little that I don't want to forget about as well. So. Next question here from the Q&A chat section. With so much of the American budget going towards the police instead of providing a foundation for a healthy society, how do we change things?
I thought you were going to ask me what's the meaning of life, but I'm glad you gave me a softball question. That's a difficult question. Let me start there. So I'm a person who has done a lot of work to change policies and change laws all across the country in many different states and in DC. And at the same time, one of the lessons I learned really early on in my career when I landed at a nonprofit public interest law firm is that changing a law doesn't change hearts and minds. And that you don't get to the finish line from just shifting policy or shifting budgets. Yes, budgets are important. Budgets are a statement of your priorities. But I think for us to get back to a place where we think about things like compassion and humanity, I'm thinking about this video I saw yesterday of these Syracuse police officers dragging this child around because he stole a bag of chips. And I just kept thinking, is there not one of these police officers that says this doesn't feel right? This is wrong. We shouldn't be doing this. And how do we get back there? I think we have to try to get back there by some version of what I said earlier. I'm going to be a bit of a broken record here. I remember a story. I remember walking into a meeting about 8 years ago. And when I walk into meetings, I look around the room and I try to sit next to the person who I think I have the least in common with. And I do that because I think there's a moment to try to learn from each other. And I sat next to the head of the Michigan Department of Correction Union, white guy, about my age, had worked in corrections his whole life and was now the head of the union. And they gave out these cards about the size of my phone. And you were supposed to choose 5 cards that tell a story about your life. And the cards had pictures on them. And he chose his 5 cards. I chose mine. Other people chose their cards. And as I peeked over to him, I realized that 4 of his cards were just like mine. He literally chose 4 of the same cards. And then when we had to go around the room and explain why we chose the cards, his explanation for choosing those cards were very similar to mine. Grew up in a poor community. Lots of his friends got locked up. Some of his friends got killed. He didn't see a future for himself. Correction was a way out. Like, there were just so many things that reminded me of like my brother, myself, and so on. We're still friends. We're still friends. I'm not in the work the way I used to be, and we still have a relationship. And more importantly, when he feels like he's not getting it right, he calls me up. And when I notice someone in his system was being treated poorly, I call him up. That would never have happened if we didn't create that proximity with each other in that room. So I know that, I hope that doesn't sound too Pollyannish. And I don't think we're gonna get out of the mess we got ourselves into overnight, because it took us a long time to get here, death by a million cuts. But I genuinely think, putting aside for a second the importance of shifting laws and shifting policies and shifting budgets, that until we get to the point where there's more relationships like that, we're going to continue to see a world where people are hugely separated and very punitive with each other.
You all will have to forgive me. We had a test of our emergency notification system on campus, and it's about 1,000 decibels, so I didn't want to mute myself. You've just been so thoughtful and just dropping the knowledge. And I'm picking up on this theme, right? Because there's been some profound kind of high level questions, right? Particularly the one about money, right? What I'm hearing, or what kind of my interpretation of that. Give me a quick second.
The best laid plans.
All right, that should just about conclude that test. It works, by the way, it works well. So just to keep it brief in the spirit of time, we do have a little bit of time, but one of the themes that I'm kind of picking up here is like, there's systemic issues, right? There are some problems in our society that privilege some and continue to marginalize others. And at the end of the day, what it really comes down to is like, we want this collective change, we'll call it, maybe at the institutional system level, but it's really at the individual level. Like, I think that's what I'm hearing from Glenn is like, it's the relationships. Like, I hear this bridge building like concept essentially, right? I'm learning from you, you know, like sitting next to someone in a room and being intentional and looking at, picking up on cues and features and intentionally sitting next to someone who you think is different than you in many respects to learn about that person, right? We can all learn from that. And if we all learn from that and think about how we can apply that to our own circumstances, like collectively, then I think we can create the change that Dr. Little encouraged us to think about in the beginning of our day together.
Yeah, so you made me think of an experience I had about 7 or 8 years ago. I was at the beginning of a march in Manhattan. It was a Black Lives Matter march, and I was at the front of the line. And there were only about 20 of us in the beginning. We started at Washington Square Park, downtown Manhattan. And within 5 blocks, there were hundreds of us. And within 10 blocks, there were thousands of us, like tens of thousands of us. And I was just so proud to be there on the front line marching for issues that were so important. And then for a minute, I looked to my left and I looked to my right, and I noticed that I was flanked by about 10 people on each side, and they were all looking down at their phones. And at that point, my heart felt really heavy. And it felt really heavy because I said to myself, like, sustainable movements are built based on relationships. Like, you know, data is a compilation of anecdotes, and movements are like a compilation of relationships, one-on-one relationships that matter. Like, people pick up the phone and call people and they show up at a rally because of their relationship with that person, their trust in that person. And I became very worried that as impactful as social media can be, I don't want to totally discount it, there are things that we've lost. And so seeing everyone spending their time showing the rally and showing the role they were playing in the rally, and maybe even, just to be fair, trying to inspire people to come out and join, what I thought we lost in that moment and what has always stayed with me was, like, people weren't talking to each other, to the person right next to them. And so, yes, I'm a big believer that those one-on-one relationships, like the same way that person told me you should go to college, like, you just never know where those conversations, those sort of morsels of trust can lead in terms of changing an entire world. One of the first things you learn when you're doing social science, which was part of my liberal arts degree, is Margaret Mead's quote about don't ever doubt that a small group of people can change the world. It's the only thing that ever has. And I think that only happens if people build relationships.
Wow, no doubt. I think when you opened up, you said something, if I wrote this down correctly, about creating the world you want to live in. And I think that's what you're speaking to right now. So, like, so we're coming full circle to the way you opened up, right? And it's true, it is so true, and yet powerful. We have a few more questions that came in.
This is State Center Community College District.
Give me a sec, everyone.
I'll say something while you're on hold real quick. Sorry, I'll say something while you're on hold real quick. People often say to me, Glenn, you seem the most free you've ever been in your life right now. And it's actually because I've created the world I want to live in. Even in the middle of the madness of the world, like, I live in a world that's very liberating, very free, very loving, very supportive, very warm, all of those things, very happy. I got to be honest, I didn't always live in that world. And there's, you know, there's glitches in the matrix. I also don't want people walking away from this talk thinking my life is all roses. Like everyone else's life, you don't go from, you know, things not going well to things going well in a linear way. Like, life is much more of a roller coaster. Mine is also, but I have been able to create a world that feels truly free, because I do believe that each of us can help create the world we want to live in.
Thank you for that, Glenn, and thank you for jumping in and stepping up. Our college takes things serious, I guess, when it comes to these tests, and I apologize for that.
It's all good.
A few more questions. What role do you think the community college system setting can play in reentry?
Yeah, people closest to the problem are closest to the solution. So community college are embedded in communities, and they have staff that are of and from the community, and they have people showing up there that are of and from the community. And it's sometimes communities that where the community college is the only resource, the primary resource. So if we can get an institution that people are familiar with, that is generally, you know, at least admittedly going to be funded, even though it's never funded enough, to believe in the value of every single person in that community, and to become this vehicle for helping people who are returning to the community to feel wanted and part of a community and safe. I think the outcomes of that would be immeasurable, because if you want to, you know, people think tough on crime is the way to go. Like, if you believe in like protecting people from becoming victims, then you do more of what works and less of what doesn't. And if you want people to become victims of crime, like, teach people who are coming home from prison that they don't belong. Put them under a bridge. Don't give them an opportunity. Don't help them get a job. Because the lesson you teach them is that no one's looking out. No one cares. Like, this act that I'm about to do, like, there's no one here who loves me enough to care or cares enough to love me. Like, and so I actually think community colleges can become this hub of safety, which may sound strange, for people who are coming home from prison, because the line I see that people draw between victims and offenders didn't live in the real lives of the people I met in prison. They were both. I am both. Each of you are both. Like, people don't live in the thick lines that we tend to draw just so that we can move forward and feel comfortable that society and life is manageable. People are much more complex than that. And I think until we break away from these binaries, which community colleges can allow us to do, I think we're going to continue to have it be an us versus them mentality. Having said that, just to put a silver lining on this, I actually have seen more and more community colleges stepping up to the plate. And I think it's not just the right thing to do, and there's so many lives saved, and I don't think we'll ever be able to measure that. But I think the more we normalize, you know, if there's one thing I've learned about movement building, is that if you give enough people the courage to come out of the closet, if you will, then other people come right out behind them, right? The more Glenn Martin says, yeah, yep, I'm an entrepreneur, I'm wealthy, and guess what? I served time in prison and I met some of America's best and brightest, is the more a guy like Jay, my business partner, says, God damn, I want to get on the phone with you. Like, and I want to tell people I'm formerly incarcerated too. So yes, community colleges can lead the way, and many of them are, and you guys clearly have a model that people can learn from.
Wow. Thank you, Glenn. We're trying to change the narrative, right? In the midst of what you're describing and sharing with us, it's also about changing the narrative in community colleges. And the work that we do here, community colleges are open access institutions, right? But we also know access without success is useless, as the great Terrell Strayhorn once wrote. What I maintain is access without equity is an unfulfilled promise, right? And I think that resonates with your comment about how people closer to the problem are closest to the solution, right? And so I think that it's very apropos and very just, you know, germane to what you're saying so thoughtfully. Thank you for that. So we have one more question, and then we have a comment, which is just perfect, because this comment that I'll share after you respond to this question, it's from a faculty colleague. And I think that the comment speaks for all of us here. So let's start with the last question here first. So this question reads, what prompted you to start Just Leadership?
Yeah, that's a really good question. Thank you. So I went from exiting prison to landing at a nonprofit public interest law firm after searching for a job for a month and being turned down by employers over and over. Visited about 50 different employees, couldn't even sell sunglasses because of my criminal conviction. Landed at a nonprofit public interest law firm, really elevated there to the point where I hit a glass ceiling because I'm not a trained lawyer, and then moved on to a place called the Fortune Society to be the vice president. And then stayed there for 6.5 years also, particularly because I wanted to start exercising this idea of like people closest to the problem, closest to the solution. And at the law firm, because I wasn't a lawyer, I didn't have clients. At Fortune Society, I was the head of policy and advocacy. So I built out that unit. I took over communications. I took over fundraising. I took over programs. But more importantly, I was doing advocacy work with formerly incarcerated people, helping to shape the work and lead the advocacy work. And I got to the point where I went from my first job, which was $16,000 a year, owing $83,000 in fines, fees, restitution, and child support, to making 180 grand a year at one of the largest, longest standing reentry organizations in the world. And then I had a meeting with Jeff Sessions. Yes, that Jeff Sessions. And I was trying to convince him to bring college back to prison across the country. And I was with Dallas Pell, the daughter of Senator Claiborne Pell, because we were trying to bring Pell grants back. And I knew I was going to do what I do well, which is like to talk policy and then switch it to like, oh, did you know I went to college in prison? Did you know the reason I'm standing here? You know, it's a very effective way to go. And I did that. And he was blown away at the end of the meeting. He was like, wow, I really haven't. He's like, I can't. You? And he was just, you know, dumbfounded. And literally within 60 seconds, he pivoted and said, well, you know what? Just because a blind squirrel finds a nut doesn't mean I'm going to change a law. And you know what he was really saying is like, Glenn, you're the exception. And the more I emerged as the exception is the more it reinforced the rule. And the more I became the one out of six or seven formerly incarcerated people in this country who were doing something amazing is the more it could reinforce the rule for people who didn't believe in folks like us to say, yeah, of course you got a handful of people who are doing well, because the majority of the others, they just need to try harder or they just are incapable. It's the argument some people make when Black folks say we need opportunity, we need equity. People say, oh, well, look at Michael Jordan. Who points out examples of white people who've made it? Like, you know, we point out examples of people of color who made it. And the same way people started pointing out examples of formerly incarcerated people who made it. And I was one of them. And I didn't feel good about that. And so I quit that job with nothing but a concept paper and a vision. And was sitting on this balcony right here, 2 feet away from me in Harlem, scared to death, not having a job, not knowing what was next. But I knew that I wanted to take my 13 years at the time of experiences that led to me being so successful and try to package that and share it with other formerly incarcerated people to essentially build an army of formerly incarcerated leaders who could sit with the Jeff Sessions of the world and others and use their compelling individual stories to try to move hearts and minds. And that's really what drove it. And then the reason I started with a mission of cutting the number of people under correctional supervision in half by 2030 is because my son Joshua had recently been born, and 1 in 3 Black men are going to end up in prison by the age of 18, and Josh is going to be 18 in 2030. And I knew the work would be hard and difficult and scary, and I wanted something to wake me up every day and really motivate me to do the work. And then lastly, the initial bold effort to try to shut down Rikers, we did that because we felt like if we could get at one of the most insidious institutions of mass incarceration, at the very least, we can inspire people all around the country to say, I wonder what else is possible.
Thank you for everything that you do, Glenn. Continue to do. I'm increasingly impressed. As much as I thought I knew about you, I'm learning so much. Just and thank you for these questions that are coming through. It's truly inspiring and encouraging for me, and I trust all of us here. So Glenn, there's a last comment. As I mentioned, this is not a question, but this is again from a faculty colleague here at Fresno City College. And so this reads, thank you, thank you, thank you. Exclamation points. Let me say that again. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Your journey is heartbreaking, infuriating, and inspiring, both in terms of personal growth and systemic change. I think that is an absolute fitting comment and timely in closing this out. I cannot thank you enough for sharing space and time with us, imparting some of your life experiences, expertise, and knowledge. We have learned a lot. And I really could not think of a more fitting way to kick off this 2-day Rising Scholar Symposium. And so from on behalf of me and all the colleagues here at Fresno City College and the Office of Student Equity and Success, we truly thank you for speaking with us and sharing time with us. So let's give Glenn a physical or virtual round of applause, and let's make this as enthusiastic and exciting as we possibly can in a virtual environment. So. Thank you so much, man.
Cool. Thanks again. I'm really honored to have been here. Good luck with the rest of the symposium. And I noticed that we kept I think, almost all of our audience. And so that's a pretty good sign that I delivered, and I appreciate that as a feedback. Thanks, everyone.
Absolutely, thank you. And so for everyone else, just a couple housekeeping things here before we close out. We have a little break now until 10:30 to 11:45 is going to be the first breakout sessions of the day, followed by a lunch break from noon to 1 p.m. Thereafter lunch, we will have our second breakout sessions of the day from 1 p.m. to 2:15 p.m. And you do not want to miss the last event of the day, and that is our student panel, who will be facilitated by one of our peer mentors, Ms. Victoria Rocha. Please do come back. In these virtual spaces, it's difficult to see where people go because we can't see where you're at, but we trust that you will join us if you can, and we hope that you will join us and come back to the breakout sessions and the final panel at the end of the day. So with that, wish you a great morning, and let's all break to our rest right now. And we'll be back at 10:30 to log in for the breakout sessions. And as a reminder, you can log into your sessions based on how you registered and how you have the breakout session links. So thanks again, everyone.